Hello, welcome to Free Bible Commentary with Pastor Teacher Dr. Bob Utley. Be sure to visit Free Bible Commentary at www.freebiblecommentary.org. Now, here's Bob.
We're going to begin the book of Philippians today. We're going to be in chapter 1, verses 1 through 11. The structure seems to break down like this. Verses 1 and 2 are a general introduction, very characteristic of Paul. Then verses 3 through 8 are going to be a prayer of thanksgiving for the Philippians. And then verses 9 through 11, Paul is going to pray for the Philippians. And so that basically is structure. Matter of fact, this whole book almost breathes a prayer of joy. I think you're going to really love this book. It's one of the most intimate books of Paul. To a church he seemed to have such a unique affection for because they had a unique affection for him. Now, notice if you would, it says Paul. The word means little. We think there's two possible origins. One, from the second century book, Paul and Thelka, that he was a short person. And maybe he took the word Paul to show his height. Now, some say he always had two names, his Hebrew name Saul and a Greek name Paul. And when he started working with the Greek churches, he took the Greek name. Others say, no, the word means little, and he picked it up as a characteristic of his physical stature. Others say, no, based on like 1 Corinthians 15:9, he says, I'm the least of the apostles because I persecuted the church. And he took the word Paul to describe his sense of leastness. Now, if you know the book of Galatians, he would say he's perfectly equal with the apostles, but he sensed that God did a wonderful work of grace in his heart in calling him from persecutor to apostle. Now, and Timothy. Now, of course, Timothy is Paul's lieutenant, one of his favorite co-workers, like Titus. He was converted on the first missionary journey, picked up on the second journey as a helper. He is connected with all of Paul's activity with Philippi. He is sent back. We see that in Acts 16 is the initial encounter of Paul at Philippi with Timothy. He was sent back to Philippi, we learn from Acts 19:22. And then from chapter 2 of Philippians, he was either sent again or had further contact with them. Timothy is, of course, half Jew, half Greek, but Paul circumcised him to be able to work with Jews. Now, notice it mentions slaves of Jesus Christ. Now, there's two things here. The word slave is the word for servant. It can mean slave in contradistinction to Christ's lordship. Or, I think a better possible origin of this concept is the Old Testament use of the servant of the Lord, servant of Yahweh, for people like Moses and Joshua and David and the prophets. But notice that this unique thing in the New Testament, instead of slaves of Yahweh, it's slaves of Jesus Christ. This is a very common way for the New Testament authors to assert the full deity of Christ by substituting his name and characteristic titles for God. This can also be seen a little bit lower down in verse 6 where it says the day of Jesus Christ. It's usually the day of Yahweh. And you see that from many places in the Old Testament. A good example would be Amos 5, 18 through 20. So here's another example of a characteristic title for the God of the Old Testament now applied to Jesus. Now, the words Christ Jesus and Jesus Christ are kind of flip-flopped and doesn't seem to be any real significance in the order of the terms, although Christ is, of course, the Greek equivalent of the Hebrew word Messiah, which is the office that Jesus of Nazareth had, and Jesus was given by the angel, Matthew 1:21. It means Yahweh saves. When it's used by itself, it usually refers to the humanity of Jesus. And to all God's people. Now, the word here is saints. It's always in the plural except one time in this book, chapter 4, verse 21, I believe. But even there, it's in a corporate context. So the ideal is that to be a believer is to be a part of a believing community. The word saint is from the word holy, which has an Old Testament background, to be set apart for God. Now the idea here is not that we are holy in the sense that we never sin. There's been some confusion here with the Roman Catholic use of this term for especially fruitful or effective Christians. But the truth is, if you're a believer, you're a saint. It speaks of our position in Christ. And yet, because we are by grace in Christ, because we have the imputed righteousness of Jesus, 2 Corinthians 5:21, we're going to try to live out that relationship. You might want to see verse 10. This first chapter has a unique combination of the fact that we're in Jesus by the grace of God, but because we're in Jesus by grace, we're going to try to progressively be more like Him. And that is maybe a paradox, but it's a very important paradox when you look at Paul's concept of justification by faith and the idea of progressive sanctification. Now, notice if you would here where it mentions then, in union with Christ Jesus. Now, this is Paul's characteristic phrase. It's a locative sphere. As birds fly in air, as fish swim in water, that's how we are in Christ. It's a very unique and beautiful phrase of our incorporation. Williams makes it in union with him. Who are at Philippi? And, of course, Philippi, as you know from your outline notes on the background of this book, was a Roman colony. And I think that's very significant because it was like a little Rome. Several different waves of Roman citizens had been retired there, particularly the soldiers of Anthony. Now, notice it says, who are overseers and assistants, or with the overseers and assistants. The letter is addressed to all the church, but also the church leaders. Now, the word overseers and assistants is the word episkopoi and diakonoi, which basically we get the term bishop or overseer from. Now, I want to talk about that a minute. This is the only place I know of where the two offices in the local church are mentioned, except in 1 Timothy 3, where the office of the bishop and then the altar office of the deacon, and possibly the deaconess, is mentioned in 1 Timothy 3. Now, here we have the two offices. Overseer seems to have a Greek background and administrator of a city, where the term elder seems to have a Jewish background from the Old Testament and the synagogue. It is obvious to me from Acts chapter 20, verses 17 and 28, in Titus chapter 1, verses 5 and 7, that the term presbyteroi, we get elder, and episkopoi, we get bishop, are synonymous terms with pastor in the New Testament. Now, it is true that the overseer has a Greek background, although from the Dead Sea Scrolls, we have found a similar term in Hebrew, similar to overseer, and maybe the concept was quite common even in the Jewish churches of Paul's day. Now, the word assistant, we get the word deacon. Deacon is a word for ministry or service. It comes, we think, from raising dust, either from household duties or rapid movement. It's the idea of someone who serves. It's used quite often for simply the apostles ministering. Deacons were the assistants, and if the origin is Acts 6, which I'm not sure of, if it is, it's the concept of spiritually gifted men, but in menial tasks of service. Now, why these both are mentioned here, some say because the deacons or assistants helped with the contribution they sent to Paul, and that's very possible. Some say the same concept is mentioned in 1 Corinthians 12:28 about helpers and administrators would be somewhat synonymous with overseers and their assistants. Now, notice where it mentions in verse 2. Spiritual blessing. This is the word grace. It's very important to me that our union with Christ is something He gives to us by grace. You might want to see 1 Corinthians 1:30. Now, this grace is the undeserved, unmerited grace of God. Paul took the characteristic Greek greeting, charon. You might want to see James 1:1, where charon, or rejoice, is used, and changed it slightly with a similar word sound to charon, which is grace, and made it uniquely Christian. I'm not sure we can say that grace and peace are the Greek and the Hebrew greetings combined. I'm not sure that's true. I think we can say that grace always precedes peace, and this is a characteristic way, the normal form of writing letters in Paul's day. From God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Now, God is Father, not in the sense of chronological sequence or sexual generation, but God described Himself to man in intimate family terms, and this is one example of God as Father. Now, the word Lord Jesus Christ, the word Lord, is the New Testament author's way of asserting deity to Jesus of Nazareth by again attributing to Jesus a title for the Old Testament God. The Old Testament Jews were afraid to pronounce the covenant name for God, Yahweh, Exodus 3:14. So they pronounced the Hebrew word Adonai, which means husband, owner, master. And when Jesus is called Lord, it's their way of attributing to Him this same sense of deity. Very significant, I think. Now, in verse 3, every time I remember you, there's a grammatical problem here based on interpretation of the syntax of the sentence. Is this an objective genitive or a subjective genitive? If it's a subjective genitive, and I think that may be true because of the use of the dative here, if it is, it refers to the gift that this church sent Paul. If it's an objective genitive, as it is most often used, then it's simply a normal way of Paul saying, remember, I remember you, instead of you remember me. Now, which it is, we're not certain. There are different translations, and you can check the notes if you would. Now, notice where it says, I thank my God. Now, the word thank here is a word we get the word Eucharist from. The word originally means thanksgiving. It's the idea of this fellowship and thanksgiving to God for who we are. Verse 4, I always do it with joy at every entreaty I make for all of you. Now, some see, like Lightfoot and others, that verse 4 is a parenthesis. If verse 4 is a parenthesis, then verse 5 is connected to verse 3, which backs up the idea that this is a reference to the gift the church gave to Paul. I think because of the possibility of the translation of verse 3, because I think verse 4 probably is a parenthesis, and verse 5 and 7 can be linked to the church's gift to Paul through terms and inferences, I think this whole passage of 3 through 8 basically is Paul thanking this church for the gifts they continually sent to him, probably several times. The one we have listed in Philippians is through Epaphroditus, who came to him and got sick. Now, notice if you would where it mentions here then, with joy. Paul is in prison, and yet this prison epistle is characterized by joy. There are four prison epistles. There's Colossians, Ephesians, and Philemon, which seem to be written early in Paul's imprisonment, sometime in the early 60s. And then Philippians seems to be later in Paul's imprisonment. He's a little bit more uncertain about the possibility of his release. Some even said Ephesians might be like Paul's last will and testament as far as him thinking he might die. And that is possibly true. So it's a very important book because of that aspect. The word joy is the word joy is in 1:4, 1:25, 2:2, 2:29, and 4:1. The word rejoice, which is a form of that same word, is in 1:18, 2:17, 2:18, 2:28, 3:1, and 4:4. The compound rejoice with is found in 2:17 and 18. This epistle is characterized by joy. It's amidst the persecution that Paul is suffering in imprisonment and possibly the persecution the church is under from the heretics that have infiltrated this particular church. Now, they seem to be Judaizers because of chapter 3, somewhat like the heretics at Galatia. Now, notice if you would, where it mentions, I make for all of you, the entreaty I make for all of you. That's very important. This all of you is very common, this book. If you'll notice a number of times the word all or every or that kind of emphasis, it seems to be an emphasis on the unity that Paul is asking these Christians to have in the midst of the exclusivists and the divisions called by the false teachers. I think it's a significant use of the word all in this book. Now, verse 5. For your cooperation in the spreading of the good news from the first day you heard it until now. Now, your cooperation is a beautiful idea. I think it refers to that gift they sent Paul. It's the word koinonia, which means joint participation in. This word is used several times for the giving of money and translated contribution. You might want to see a couple, Romans 15:26, 2 Corinthians 9:13, 1 Timothy 6:18 is some examples of it translated contribution. Now, so the first day they heard of it refers back to Acts 16 where they first received the gospel, beginning with Lydia and then the slave girl who was demon-possessed and then the Philippian jailer and many, many more beyond that. Now, I think it's real important that we link verse 5 and verse 6 together. Their cooperation, they had a voluntary aspect in participating with Paul in the gospel, probably financially with his help and Paul. By giving to Paul, they had a part in his ministry, and also spreading the gospel themselves. Now, here is an emphasis on their effort. They were doing something. But look at verse 6. Verse 6 emphasis on what God is doing. Now, this is a real paradox. Is Christianity basically what God does for us, or is Christianity what we do for God? Yes. God's grace always comes first, as verse 6 is so sure. Now we'll see John 6, 44 and 65. God always comes first. God always takes initiative. But God has chosen that man must respond to his love. I think a good parallel to this balance between man's response and God's initiating love is found in chapter 2 of Philippians, verses 12 and 13. This balance is crucial in understanding that we're saved completely by grace, but then we give our whole life to him in service. God's grace always comes first, but it issues in lifestyle. You might well see Ephesians 2, 8 and 9 emphasizing God's grace, not man's merit, but verse 10 of Ephesians 2 emphasizing that we are foreordained to good works. That's the emphasis here. Now, verse 6 is very important. Paul says, I'm certain, perfect tense, of this very thing, that he who began a good work in you will go on until the day of Jesus Christ to complete it. This is the idea we're saved by grace and we're kept by grace. You might want to see John, I believe it's 17:11, and 1 Peter 1:5 for some of this inference that the keeping power of God. Hallelujah. Notice that God began it in grace. Now, the word doesn't say God here, but it's implied in the text. In several places in Galatians, God's not mentioned, but it's obvious that He's the subject of the sentence, as He is in verse 6. Now notice the word begin is an aorist participle. God began it once and for all. That's the idea of completed action. He started it. Now the word begin and complete both have sacrificial implications. I think that's significant. Both these terms are used in sacrificial context. Obviously, God began it through the sacrifice of Christ. Now, notice where it says, until the day of Jesus Christ. Very often in the opening of Paul's letters, he mentions the second coming. It's really an impetus for service. It's the idea that God is coming to get them and they're to be faithful till He comes. This introductory mentioning of the second coming is found in 1 Corinthians 1:7, 2 Corinthians 1:10, Colossians 1:5, and 1 Thessalonians 1:10. And really, I think you can see it in 2 Thessalonians also. Now, notice where the day of Jesus. Notice it's not the day of the Lord anymore. It's the day of Jesus Christ. This is obviously a reference to the second coming here. The second coming is mentioned in chapter 1, verse 6, chapter 1, verse 10, and chapter 2, verse 16. It's a common thread throughout the book of Philippians. Now, the word completed means to bring to fruition, to bring to completion. God's going to consummate in grace what He began in grace. Hallelujah! The keeping power of God. You ought to read John 10 again. Now, verse 7. And I have a right to think this way about you because I always have you in my heart. Now, this can mean I am close to your heart. It can be translated either way again. Some see a reference to the contribution they made to him. Some see the normal use of Paul of remembering his churches. I personally see it as a reference to their contribution to him. Whether shut up in prison or out. Now, these two words, defending and vindicating the good news. These are both legal terms. The first one, we get the English word apology, meaning a legal defense. You might want to see Acts 22:1, Acts 25:16, 2 Timothy 4:16. The second word meant a down payment in a legal sense and is used in Hebrews 6:16. You might want to see that. This seems to be Paul referring to his trial before the Roman authorities that Ananias told him because God told Ananias that he would stand before kings for Jesus Christ. For you are sharers with me. Now this is the word soon. The little preposition soon means joint participation with, and koinonia again. So it's the idea of you are sharers in the grace of God. And I think that's a beautiful thing here. I think the King James translation is unfortunate, and you might want to compare that for what it really is not saying. Now notice in verse 8 then where it says, for God is my witness. Now Paul uses God quite often to verify the truth of his statements. In a sense, this is a religious oath. You know, we'll see Romans 1:9, 2 Corinthians 1:23, and 1 Thessalonians 2:8-10. How I never stop yearning for you. This word yearning is used by Paul of his desire to see it with his own eyes believers he has known. Maybe it's a yearning to get out of prison in a way. You might want to see Romans 1:11, 1 Thessalonians 3:6, 2 Timothy 1:4. For all of you with the affections of Christ. This is the word bowels. It was used in Greek world for the heart, the lungs, and the major organs. But in Hebrew, it seemed to mean the lower viscera. So that's where the emotions came from. If you ever eaten hot sauce too late, you know why the ancients thought that's where the seat of the emotions. So it's the bowels of mercy. And this is the idea, maybe in our translation, heart would be better. He's saying, I feel for you as Christ feels for you. Oh, beautiful. Now, verses 9 through 11 is the closing aspect of this prayer. Now he's going to pray for them. He's prayed in thanksgiving to God. Now he's going to pray a petition for them. And it's very important, this petition that he prays. It is my prayer that your love, this is the word agape, the self-giving love. The church poured meaning into this Greek word. It's a word that meant the self-giving love of God seen in Christ. You might want to see 1 Corinthians 13 where love is so beautifully described. You might want to see Galatians 5:22 where it says the fruit, singular, of the Spirit, singular verb, is love. And the rest of that is a characteristic of love. You might want to see the book of Colossians. Let me think if I can think of that reference. I believe it's Colossians 1:14, but I forgot to write that down, where Colossians speaks of overflowing love. He wants their love to overflow. Now, how is their love going to overflow? Notice it's present tense. It's going to continue to overflow. Okay? It's purposeful love, not emotional love. Still more and more directed. Now, here's two things that love's going to do. Love is not so much emotional, but it's purpose. It's teleological oriented. It's goal oriented. Now, here, Its focus is in the two aspects, fuller knowledge and keener insight. Now, the first one is an intensified form of the word know. It's epignosko. It seems to be used for our relationship with God, full and complete knowledge of God that comes from God's initiating love in us and our faith response. We're going to have love because we know God. Now, the second word, keener insight, is a word that means perception. Some see this as we're going to have an understanding of the gospel because of our relationship to God in Christ, and then we're going to make appropriate moral choices because of our relationship with God. So I think it's true. The second one may have a real concept of choosing the right way. And of course, with false teachers present, you can see how important this is, both in relations to the unbelieving world and relations to the false teachers in the midst of the church at Philippi. Then it says in verse 10, so that you may always approve the better thing. Now, the word approve is a word that means to test. It's a metallurgy term, quite often used to biting a coin to see if it's real. It comes to be used in the New Testament with a connotation of to test with a view toward approval. Now, the better things, I think you ought to look at 1 Corinthians 10, verses 23 and 32, and 1 Corinthians 14. It's the idea of helping build up the church. The better things are the thing that's going to lead not to the abuse of freedom, but to the responsibility of freedom, to the responsibility of loving our fellow Christian and evangelizing a lost world. That seems to be the better things that overflowing love is going to do. Now, notice where it says, and be men of transparent character and blameless. Now, the word transparent has two possible origins. Some say it's the idea of unmixed, and you can see in your notes where I reference to that in Peter's letters. Others say no, and the etymology is doubtful, I agree. It comes from the root for the word sun and means to test pottery in the sun to see if it was cracked and had wax filled in the cracks. So whatever it is, I think transparent character catches that. We're not to act one way here and one way here as men pleasers. We're to have a transparent godliness that is the same in all situations, not religious chameleonism that's so common in the church today. And then finally, the word blameless. This has a background without offense. I think it's very similar to no handle for criticism. Different word, but same concept in 1 Timothy chapter 3 about church leaders. We're to have transparent, obviously godly lives is the idea here. Now, then it says, men that are abounding. And the word abounding is a perfect passive participle. We abound in the past. We continue abounding. We don't abound. God abounds in us as we yield ourselves to Him. It's the word to feel full of something. The fruit, singular, of right doing or righteousness. This is obviously the aspect of Paul's doctrine of justification by faith. We can't bear fruit of righteousness, but as we yield ourselves to the power of the Spirit of God flowing through us, God can work a miracle of the Christian life in our yieldedness. This is so important that we see as we're called saints positionally. Now in verses 10 and 11, we're told to live like saints. We're saints because of the imputed righteousness of Christ, but now we're to walk worthy of the calling wherewith we've been called. We're to walk in the light as He is in the light. You catch the idea there? We're in Him, now we're to live a Christ-like life. That's so important we see that. Now, this right doing is used several times. Matter of fact, I think it's from several Old Testament passages like Proverbs 11:30 and Amos 6:12. The word fruit of something is used in the New Testament several times with different kind of words, fruit of light, fruit of this. This is the fruit of righteousness. Some say you ought to see Galatians 5:22 about the fruit of the Spirit is love. Similar idea, because love is mentioned in this context. Now, how do we do this? Now, mine has with the help of Jesus Christ. It's the Greek word through. The agency, the means, the power to do this fruit of righteousness comes from our union with Jesus Christ, who we didn't initiate, but God initiated, 1 Corinthians 1:30. The power for godliness flows through us from God. It's His will that we be like Him. God's will for every Christian is not just salvation, a ticket to heaven when you die, but it's Christ likeness in every believer that's going to attract others to God through Christ. God's heart beats for a lost world, and His way is a gospel that touches individuals, changes their lives, and then touches other individuals. To the honor and praise of God. That's a very important phrase. Why? Well, some see in Ephesians chapter 1, where it talks of the Father's, Son's, and Spirit's ministry, at the close of that, it says that every one of those are for the praise of God. God's working in men to bring honor to God. It reminds me a lot of Matthew 5:16, that they'll see our good works but glorify our Father in heaven. The Christian life, people shouldn't pat us on the head and say, oh, what a wonderful, cute, little, honest, godly person you are. They ought to see our lives and be so drawn to that kind of freedom, that kind of morality, that kind of power, that kind of peace, that kind of love, that kind of acceptance, that they're going to say, what is it in you? How do you do life with this kind of quality and this kind of joy? How do you do it? You do it in Jesus Christ. You come to God's initiating love, and you yield yourself to that love. And lo and behold, that love starts bubbling out of you, as John would put it. It's like God turns on that spring of living water that gushes out of a Christian's life on all who are around. And friends, they're so thirsty to see Jesus. They don't need religiosity. They don't need more sermons and bigger church buildings. What they need is real Christians that live and move in the same atmosphere and workplace and school and problems they work in, but with a real difference, a difference that transforms their lives, and if given the opportunity, will transform all that are around them. Praise be unto God. What a prayer. I think that's a prayer not only for these Philippian Christians, but for us too.